Tonight, 2015. And if Commissioner Brown would please lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
Please stand. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay. And Mr. Petches, would you like to call the roll?
Commissioner Eggleston.
Here.
Commissioner Barnes.
Here.
Commissioner Brown.
Here.
Chair Darden.
Here.
Commissioner Crandall.
Here.
Commissioner Rulon.
Here.
Commissioner Smith.
Here.
Okay. Thank you, Jim. I'd like to welcome our new Assistant City Attorney, Matthew Mal Richardson, and he has promised us that the Mal does not stand for malpractice. Would you like to introduce yourself, Mal?
Or malware.
Is this where I dance my jig?
Is that later?
Mal Richardson. I'm a partner with Best Best and Krieger. Scott Smith, the city attorney, is my long-term partner. I'm a city attorney for two cities in Orange County, now the assistant in San Clemente. I specialize in complex land use planning issues. That's kind of the boring stuff. I'm from Huntington Beach, grew up there, raising my family there. I've got a bunch of kids. Spent a lot of time in South County. My wife's from South County, from San Juan Capistrano, actually. I spent far too much time surfing here in San Clemente, so it's kind of a second home. Went to UCLA Law School, and I'm just an Orange County kid, and I'm happy to be here with you guys. Hopefully we can have some fun together and do some good planning.
Well, that's great, and you made a couple of Bruins very happy hearing that, so that's great. And we welcome your counsel and look forward to working with you. Okay, we have two sets of minutes, one from the study session of February 18th. Are there any changes to those minutes or a motion? Step up, somebody.
I'll move we adopt as written, as submitted.
Second.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye. And I abstain.
Okay, opposed? Okay, passes 6-1 abstention. And then we have a second set of minutes, those from the Planning Commission regular meeting of February 18th. I have a minor change, and I typed it out for you, Eileen. On page 8, in our discussion of the U-Haul project, I think that my comments were attributed to Commissioner Smith. I think the second part of that paragraph where it says he suggested that the existing use, and I just went back and watched the tape to make sure I got the correct language. And so this paraphrases fairly accurately what I said, but it's almost verbatim. She suggested that U-Haul engage in education of its customers. She noted that the applicant had indicated that originally the road configurations had met the need of the facility, but that an intensification of the use made them inadequate today. She said this suggests that if the applicant cannot find a way for the patrons to make use of the facility, this may no longer be an ideal use of the property. Are there any other changes or a motion?
I have a small change. On page 7, the second to last paragraph, third line down after the word to phrase traffic hazards, I would like added comma, negatively affect the Pico Scenic Corridor contrary to the general plan, comma.
Okay. Any other changes?
You know, I think I do too. Give her a second to get that.
Okay.
Need me to repeat?
Okay. Actually, I was going to ask Commissioner Smith if on page 8, if your comments there are reflective of what you said, or did I overlap, say similar things, or did I just...
I think you overlapped a little bit with Chair Darden.
Okay, so they're fine the way they are? Okay, thank you.
Okay, and then the one I had was on page 7, Commissioner Barnes, last paragraph. And then it would, in the And then it would be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, the seventh line, where it says, whereas the alternative route through Las Molinas, let me see. She drove both routes several times, finding that the applicant's preferred route took 45 seconds to drive from the freeway off-ramp, not counting wait time at two stoplights. That should be inserted. So you'd have to stop at two stoplights. And then wait in the queue to turn left into the U-Haul. And then it goes, whereas the alternative route took only 2 minutes and 15 seconds.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right. So if there are no more changes, we have a motion?
I will move we adopt as amended.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. That brings us to oral and written communication. At this point, members of the audience may address the commission on matters of public interest which pertain to the city and are not otherwise on the agenda. If you wish to speak, please step forward to the microphone, state your name and city of residence, and make your presentation. Please limit your presentation to 3 minutes. Seeing no one step forward and having no cards, we'll move on to the public hearing process. Pardon me. The public hearing process includes a staff presentation, a presentation by the applicant not to exceed 10 minutes, and public testimony. To facilitate the meeting for all attendees, the public is asked to limit their individual presentations to 3 minutes. Following closure of the public hearing, the Planning Commission will respond to questions raised during the hearing, discuss the issues, and act upon the matter by motion. The first and only item on our agenda tonight is item 8A, 550 Camino de Estrella, discretionary sign permit 15-044. / sign exception permit 15-045, Estrella Shopping Center Master Sign Program. Mr. Nicholas.
Yes. Thank you and good evening, Planning Commissioners. Sean Nicholas, Project Planner. Welcome back from your conference last week. A bit of background. The architecture, revised architecture, was recently approved back in October of 2014 for a full remodel of the existing shopping center there at 550 Camino de Estrella. For those watching at home, it is the old Kmart facility. This is for just phase one this evening. There will be a subsequent phase two component as well. But on the screen right there, you can see the approved architecture by the Planning Commission at that time. Also associated with this project, it did go to Design Review Subcommittee on February 25th. At that meeting, there was discussions associated with the monument signs, proportionality of the wall signs, as well as the long-term proportionality and locations of signs. That's kind of the key components of that, and we'll discuss how that reflects in terms of the design as we move forward. Just to orient, in case there is a question, I know Commissioner Barnes was not on commission when this was originally heard back in October. The center is this location, the old, as I said, the old Kmart Center, the area which I am now kind of circling around the whole center here, minus the bank and the gas station, down to this entryway here and in through this way, and it is just this building here. The request this evening is, Chair Darden said, is for a discretionary sign permit and a sign exception permit. The discretionary sign permit is necessary for the creation of a master sign program for the facility to establish signage both now and in the future, as well as to approve monument signs over 6 feet in height. Additionally, they are requesting a sign exception permit for wall signs to exceed 64 square feet. They are proposing with their master sign program 6 wall signs, 4 of which exceed that 64 square foot sign size, as well as one of those signs over 64 square feet is a freeway-oriented wall sign. Jumping right into it, we're going to start with the monument signage. There are going to be ultimately, excuse me, 3 locations on the site in which there will be monument signs. The map in the upper right corner shows the 3 locations. Associated with this request, they will be proposing 2 of the 3 monument signs. This, what you see here, is what I've called the primary monument sign, and it's actually located at the number 2 on the upper corner there in the map. It's at the entryway there where it kind of services both the Cornwasser property, which is the Phase 1, and then the Burnham property, which is the Phase 2 property. So it's the entryway that serves both their properties. You can see here that the monument sign does get up to a maximum of 10 feet in height associated with the topography. It will be located in a landscape planter. You can see that they've shown it is reflective of the types of landscaping at the base of the proposed monument sign, and it will be externally illuminated. As one of the components that came out of DRSC, the panels for the monument sign will all be a single color white, and just in terms of providing consistency, again, both now and the future, for any tenancy changeouts to provide some consistency. We'll allow for the individual tenants to have their individual marks, their character and copy and color on the monument signs will be reflective of their wall signs, as there will be no logos permitted associated with it, and that is a condition of approval also. I'd like to point out that the materials for the sign are high-quality materials. This is not an aluminum just frame box with a faux brick. This is true block, cinder block, real block built monument sign with a real brick cap. That's a tongue twister when you haven't had a little bit of water in a while. Could be dangerous. So it is a very high quality materials, which is one of the key components. Thank you so much. One of the key things that we looked at in terms of staff is compatibility with the architecture, but also getting high quality materials, high quality design. The inspiration for this design was actually components of the signage that we saw out at the Target and the Avenida Vista Hermosa sports park signage, taking that kind of middle portion and designing that and kind of adapting it for this use to be consistent with the architecture. So in that, staff's position is that that was successful in terms of creating something that was compatible with the shopping center's new architectural design. Also out of the coming out of design review subcommittee was the notion of creating a hierarchy of signage, particularly of the monument signage for the site. So we with that it was discussed that where is the number one is on that upper map, it is more of a secondary entrance at the signalized intersection, and with that, that the monument sign should be smaller to just kind of decrease the mass at that location. And so the applicant has agreed and reduced the square footage down for that secondary monument sign, and only has four tenant panels, still up to 10 feet in height, but it has been reduced down in terms of the whole breadth of the signage. Again, everything will be externally illuminated, and there is a condition of approval requiring that all the illumination be green code compliant and avoid all light trespass. Here is the updated master landscape plan for Phase 1. It is being reviewed currently by Pat Murphy, our contract landscape architect. So they're in the final phases of updating that. You can see here is that enhanced landscaping buffer between Camino de Estrella here and the project site. This is a minimum of a 10-foot area in through this whole area with a number of new trees along the frontage, and the black lines, the black bars here show the, oops, except for the little magnifying glass that's popping up. You can see here there's the black bar there and a black bar there, generally locating where the signs will be in a large planter area. I can tell you that each of the monument signs will be set back a minimum of 10 feet from the property line, which is pretty much back of sidewalk. So at each of those intersections, a minimum of 10 feet, and that is required based on Orange County site distance triangles in terms of people ingress, egress out of those locations. So again, I just want to make that clear. So the purpose of this is to show what planters they're going to be located in, and just note that it may be actually pushed back a little further in the planter than shown here. So that's it on the monument signs. I'm going to just continue on to the next component having to do with the wall signs. Here you can see is the color renderings of the wall signs, which was provided to the Planning Commission this evening. The applicant provided the updated architecture to the Sprouts. There was a update from what you could see from that first slide on the Sprouts. It became a little bit more horizontal, the design there, the basis of which became out of a functionality and how their store services. A big point of discussion, as I'm sure the commissioners know, and for the benefit of Commissioner Barnes, was shopping carts and wanting to make sure shopping carts weren't outside and getting them in, make sure they had a place inside. So with the new, creating the new space inside, there is now a substantially large interior space that is designated. Actually, even I've reviewed the actual tenant improvements for this, that they are putting all of their shopping carts right on the inside there, on the left and right accordingly of those two ingress egress points, so right there on the inside. So it would serve both a operational and a functionality and still accomplish the architectural goals and consistent with the Planning Commission's approval. So the staff felt that it was in substantial conformance with what the Planning Commission's design approval was, as well as their concerns regarding operations on site, as well as you can see the freeway oriented sign there on the bottom on the back side of the Sports Authority project. Here are the actual hard schematic drawings of the proportionalities and the scale of where these signs will be located proportionally, again, on these various facades. I want to, as you probably noticed, both in the Planning Commission staff report and in the Design Review Subcommittee staff reports, proportionality, design, and scale were a big part of staff's review in terms of making sure that these signs, while larger than 64 square feet, are designed proportionally and appropriate for the location in which they are to be located. And as a component of that also, and this gets back to also a lot of the discussion that came out of Design Review Subcommittee and looking at the proportionality, make sure getting it just right, because actually both of these signs were requested to be reduced just, again, to fit a little bit more within this space from the Design Review Subcommittee discussions, but also in terms of the future signage, because this is a master sign program. And it's important to note that, you know, with the sign exception approval, a future tenant would be able to come in and put up a new sign in that location. But again, looking at design and scale, ensuring consistency and proportionality with the architecture, the approval in terms of the square, the box, the area that the Planning Commission would approve. So if you were to draw a box directly around, for example, the Sports Authority or the Steinmart, that would be the location and the maximum size area of which a sign in the future could also be located. So that way, Planning Commission knows that at least located on the site proportionally, that whatever signage, both now and in the future, is in scale proportionality and its location of where the sign is proposed, as well as knowing that you will not get any larger signs. You could get smaller signs if there was a firm that wanted to have a smaller sign in that space, but you would never have a larger sign than what is approved this evening. And then similarly,
could we pause just a second?
Absolutely.
I think Jim has a question.
Yeah, I just wanted to make sure the those images, do they reflect the change in the size of the sign that the DRSC requested?
Yes.
Okay.
So I believe that, and I gave you the in your packet, the Design Review Subcommittee with the report, the minutes, and I actually gave you the sign package that was reviewed by the DRSC. So that does reflect the proportionally downscale of both Sports Authority and the Steinmart, and the slight modification to the Steinmart, the header here in this location, just to provide again the appropriate scale. But this sign was reduced as well as this sign based on the discussion. Absolutely, sir.
And just hold one more second.
Absolutely.
Sean, sorry. Mal, something that Sean said prompted a question by Commissioner Crandall. Since Commissioner Barnes was not here when we approved the architecture for this, this is a totally separate application, so there's no reason why she needed to review the tapes for the other project. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay. And she probably did, because she likes to do research. But I just wanted to make sure to get that on the record. Thank you. Okay. Go ahead, Sean.
Not a problem. So similarly, here is with the revised architecture, again, the schematic in terms of the exact proportionality and location of the signs, the scale, and look of the of how those signs will be placed on those facades. It was requested by a planning commissioner in terms of looking at an apples-to-apples comparison. So what you have here, and as a component of this whole review, is, you know, this is a sign exception permit. By right, based on the size of each of their frontages, they would be allowed to have up to 64 square feet as in the municipal code. That would not require a sign exception permit. It would still require a discretionary sign permit because of the master sign program, so on and so forth, but would not require a sign exception permit. And so, again, looking at this from a design proportionality scale, the staff asked the applicant to provide what it would look like these facades with a 64-square-foot sign versus the proposed square footage of signs. So the top represents the 64-square-foot signs on those facades. And what we had unfortunately, was just this and these two facades and nothing in a kind of stretched out facade. And so when we did receive the updated color renderings, it did look like that these matched up pretty well, and to try to give as best as we could for this evening to address that, an apples to apples comparison in terms of, again, the scale and proportionality of these two signs, the 64 versus the proposed. This tried to show that kind of on a just a flat elevation. Additionally, in your packet, you did also have all the various view simulations that were prepared for the project. And trying again to show an apples to apples, this is the view from Camino de Estrella of the proposed signage, and as it would be if it was the 64 square foot signage as viewed from Camino de Estrella. And this is again providing the view simulations in your package. So, as I said, getting to the last component of the sign exception permit request is the wall sign, the freeway-oriented wall sign on the back. Again, here's our schematic in terms of on the building plan and the proposed dimensions for this. Again, there was many visual simulations that were prepared associated with this by the applicant. The most visible areas in which the sign will be located, as it's specified in the staff report, is going to be this northbound freeway view. You will see it from the I-5. You will also see it from the southbound entry, which you can kind of see coming down here, is the southbound Estrella on-ramp. This is from the Seapoint Estates above. You can see they've actually dotted in where the center is to give you a context, but the area in which the freeway-oriented sign is not visible from the Seapoint Estates, as it's blocked primarily by Ocean View Plaza as well as the freeway landscaping. And by the way, I did verify with the engineering division, and I know that there's been a number of changes to the landscaping out there, but there is proposed to be additional landscaping, trees, shrubs, and everything planted back associated with the freeway modifications.
Wayne has a question for you.
I did not ask about walls. I just asked about the landscape.
Specifically, where was that taken from Seapoint Estates? Was that taken from, looks like someone may have climbed up the slope, but was that taken from any of the houses at Seapoint Estate?
I believe it was taken from this back. I can look at my closer up. I believe there was an address. And I apologize, it might be on actually the address, because we talked trying to look at the best to show where it would be the most visible. I don't know if we had the address right here. I don't. It just says behind Campania, the street Campania there. And I apologize, I have the address on an email in my office, but I do not have the address here, sir. But it's from a home.
It's from a home. So they specifically went through the guarded gate to take this photo. Is that correct?
You would want to ask them in terms of how they acquired this location.
Thank you.
Absolutely, sir. Again, this is from the townhome development above, also located off of, you can see here on the bottom, I tried to leave the map up for reference point 3A up here. So kind of off, this is Calle Agua right here. This is the entry. Here's Trader Joe's, just for point of reference. So from the townhome development up here, again, looking back, it's primarily blocked by, this is the Stater Brothers, as well as, again, the landscaping, and this would be the view from this back area. Again, dotted in, you can really see the dotted in kind of where that architecture will be. You will have some visibility based on this from also the bridge coming from Los Mares to Estrella, so I wanted to just to show this. This, again, it would be from, of the three locations, again, the on-ramp, southbound, the northbound I-5, and then just the bridge going over. Here is the sign right here. Again, based on staff's analysis and view of the view simulations and review of it, staff felt that it accurately showed the visual simulations from the locations and the areas in which they were taken, as well as the limited visibility, that staff felt there would not be any aesthetic impacts from the proposed freeway-oriented signage. So just in summary of the overall thing, this is one of the larger, one of the most blighted shopping centers in the community. In fact, our former community development director used to say it's the most blighted, just because of the shape of the center. We get a number of code compliance complaints, if not on a daily, a weekly basis. A number of concerns ranging from skateboarders, issues with probably unwanted people on the site, and as well as other just dumping and trash issues. Also, there is this unique project site, both in terms of how it's set back from the street, its distance from the right-of-way, also how it's topographically set from, it's below 9 to 15 feet, as I stated in the staff report, both Camino de Estrella and as well as, I believe, approximately 20 feet below the freeway as it sits on that on-ramp. And also, there's just the large facades on the with the redesign and the scale. Again, looking at the design proportionality and scale in which we try to look at the signage, make sure that it's appropriate. And again, it's high-quality materials and illuminations are proposed for this sign package. Again, I highlighted that this isn't just a shell aluminum frame box. They are proposing real block monument signs with the real red brick cap with the external illuminations and aluminum metal insets for the signs. They have the individual metal pin mounted wall signs with the halo illuminations, so it's not as obtrusive as the internal illuminations, as well as it provides, you know, an illumination for the signage is consistent to enhance the architecture. We've seen a number of signage in this illuminating this way throughout the community that was very successful in that use of the illumination, as well as all the lighting will be green code compliant and ensure no light trespass on adjacent uses and residences. With that, based on all the evaluations, staff does recommend Planning Commission approve the discretionary sign permit and the sign exception permit associated with the Estrella Center Master Sign Program Phase 1. That concludes my presentation. Staff is available for any questions any of the commissioners may have this evening.
John?
Yeah, a question, Sean. When viewing the site again, of course, we turned our plans in on the facade approval quite some time ago, but specifically on the freeway-mounted sign, how high, much higher will the building be after the facade is completed where that sign will be compared to what's there now? You have a,
That is a great question. And off the top of my head, I do not remember what the height is right there. As I said, I believe it's sunk down. That's the lowest point there, getting down to about 20 feet.
I realize that when you look there now, it's
you have a parapet right here, right, which is more or less the existing height.
That is the existing height right there, yes.
So that's whatever the distance is.
Okay, so
it's 35 feet.
I think it was like, that's what I was saying. It was like 34 to 35 feet was elevated. Coming off the top of my head.
Maybe you can pull the elevation of that from the sign up.
Yeah, it's just, it's not known, unfortunately, on there.
Well, did you see the size of the sign is 7 feet?
Yeah, 7.5. Yeah, 7 feet 4, yeah.
Mm-hmm. It doesn't seem like it goes much above the existing curb.
So maybe 7,
is,
8 feet.
Is the existing
like
brick in that rendering the existing building
yes.
now? And
yes,
then
sir.
The facade on top of it?
It's a screen wall behind it. This is the existing parapet there. And so this is from here. This is the top, obviously, to here.
Maybe 15 feet then.
So maybe another 10 or so
sure.
feet, as would be my guess. Yes, be an estimate. If I had to give an estimate here, that would be my best estimate.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, Michael.
I know that there was a lot of controversy over freeway signage with the Marblehead project. Just for a check on that, will there be freeway signage on the backside of those buildings along the freeway?
At this time, there is no proposal for freeway-oriented signage for Marblehead Coastal Commercial.
None
for the plaza, for the outlets at San Clemente, there is no proposed freeway-oriented signage with that project.
Okay. The other thing is that the planning for the freeway widening along there calls for a new sound wall all along there where there isn't one now. And it's probably going to be such that you won't be able to see the sign after the wall's built, would be my guess.
Wayne?
The question was answered.
Okay. All right. Any other questions for staff? All right. If not, let's invite the applicant up, and we can address some of our questions to him after his initial remarks.
Oh, doesn't like it. There you go.
Stephen, Sue, nice to see you again.
Very, very nice to see you again as well, Chairperson. And Commissioner Crandall, nice to see you again. My name is Stephen Yuzdan, and this is Sue Yagodzinski. from Kornwasser Shopping Center properties. I'd like to start out by thanking the commission for holding this meeting on just this matter. We know that doesn't happen all the time, and we thank you very much. Secondly, I'd like to compliment Sean Nicholas and Jim for all of their guidance and help throughout this process. They've truly been responsive and helpful, and the city is lucky to have them. So thank you very much. And lastly, I'd like to congratulate you on an excellent choice of the law school that the city attorney went to. As a 1995 graduate, I can tell you he got a great education. Some history. The site is owned by Cornland Building. Cornland Building was formed by my father-in-law, Joe Kornwasser, his father, Mark Kornwasser, and Mark's brother, Jake, who are both no longer alive. They purchased this asset encumbered by a Kmart lease. And Kmart had full control over the parcel for purposes of all maintenance of the parcel, for purposes of the parking lot, for purposes of you name it. Kmart had complete control. It was an absolute triple net lease, and the family was simply receiving a check from Kmart. My father-in-law, Joe Kornwasser, is the only member of the family who's been in the shopping center business. He entered the shopping center business in the late 70s, and in the early 80s formed a partnership with Saul Price of the Price Club, and has been developing retail centers since then. And with that expertise, it's always bothered him how the center looked. And given an opportunity, he spent a lot of time in San Diego, obviously, over the years, doing business with the Price Club, driving from L.A. to San Diego. Given the opportunity to negotiate with Kmart to recapture, to terminate the lease and regain control over the property, he leapt at the opportunity because he felt the property had been underutilized. He completed his negotiations with Kmart probably approximately 6 months ago in terms of actually regaining control over the site. So from the standpoint of history and why the site was the way it was, we just got control back of the site. I mentioned my father-in-law being the only one of the family involved in shopping centers to imply or to inform that there are other members of the family who are not in the shopping center business who really just care about the plain economics of it. But Joe, given his experience in shopping centers, and people trust me as well, having gone to UCLA Law School, how could they not? When it became known in the industry that we had control over the site, a number of offers came in. Many of those offers were from single tenant, single operator retailers. And the truth is, when you look at the building and you see how the bank and the gas station in front impact a significant portion of the building, it kind of makes sense that this building was originally planned for a single user, and those parcels or those pads were permitted years and years and years back. And right now we're inheriting the situation. But given the situation, it impacts that portion of the building. So as on the one hand, the family has the opportunity to either, as some of the family who really just look at it economically would say, well, just lease it to a single tenant user at minimal to no cost, versus what Joe's argument and my argument is, we should subdivide this. And by subdividing it, we'll be able to bring in the Sprouts and Steinmart and Sports Authority, all tenants with which we do business on a regular basis. But it's going to cost us about $11 million to do that. When all is said and done, and the improvements for the tenants, when all is said and done, in terms of enhancing the architecture to take this building from its 1960s vintage state to something that measures up to something appropriate for the city of San Clemente, and to do what needs to be done. And so we're in the position, Joe and I, of justifying to other family members why it's worth, why we should invest that $11 million, as opposed to an alternative of investing less than $1 million, and showing how it makes rational economic sense for their family to do that. It's fairly easy to do that as it relates to the Sprouts and the Steinmart, which aren't really impacted by the buildings in front of them. When it gets to Sports Authority, you know, whereas the Sprouts and Steinmart leases were signed, you know, over 2 months ago, probably over 3 months ago, the Sports Authority lease was only signed several weeks ago, probably 4 weeks ago at the most, and it has in it a termination right because they weren't going to sign the lease because of their concern about signage. And there was a there was the rendering that Sean showed previously, which shows what the signs would look like from Camino de Estrella with just the 64 with the 64 in it, is it 64
square feet
of signage. The signs would basically not be visible when we take into account the approximately 350-foot setback, when we take into account the grade differential between Camino de Estrella and the buildings, and certainly the site is at a grade differential to the freeway as well. So, you know, when all is said and done, we worked very hard with Sports Authority to get them to back off of their red background, which was shown on one of the earlier slides. We worked very, very hard with Sports Authority for them to accept the concession that I made at the Design Review Committee to reduce their letters from 8 feet to 7.5 feet. They were extremely unhappy with me. We worked very hard with Sports Authority in terms of the pin lighting for the letters as opposed to fully lit letters. And they're very unhappy with me, but you know, and as Sean knows, at every step of the way, I've spent time with Sports Authority to try to push them as far as I can possibly push them to accommodate the needs of the city, which Sean and Jim have really Chairperson Darden and Commissioner Crandall shared with us, and we've worked very, very hard to get the tenants, and in particular Sports Authority, to accommodate. And the reason, again, why Sports Authority is, if you will, the special child in this case, it's because of how impacted they are, not only visibility-wise, but also parking-wise, relative to the balance of the site. And, you know, unfortunately, we can't make this project work with only 2 out of 3 tenants. We need all 3 tenants for it to work. And we're cautiously optimistic, and you know, we definitely have some skeptics in terms of why we would be spending this money when we have an alternative. But again, we believe this is the wiser choice to go from a long-term perspective. The Sprouts lease is a 15-year lease, and the purpose is to develop to hold. We're not planning to sell this. There's absolutely no intention to sell it. It would be, from a tax standpoint, it would be very difficult, and it would be easier for the family to sit and do nothing than to sell the asset. So we're really working to accomplish what we believe would be the best redevelopment that is feasible, given market considerations, and in addition to the blight of this building and the unique historical opportunity to gain control for a redevelopment, we're also at a point in time where there are mid-box retailers who are willing and interested in making deals, which is not something that, as a shopping center developer, I can say is something that any of us can take for granted. And then we also have a unique opportunity to really be the catalyst for the redevelopment of the Burnham property. And we've developed a nice relationship with Scott Burnham, and as you can see, we've coordinated our design of the site and are really trying to make the major entrance that Sean was alluding to with the second monument sign the major entrance, and are designing it appropriately, as opposed to now when a lot of the traffic really funnels in through that easternmost entrance near closer to the bank parcel. Even though that's where the traffic signal is, So we believe that we have a very good opportunity here. We've worked very hard to accommodate the city. As those who have met with me know, that while I talk about a project having to make rational economic sense, and at the same time, I'm very open to compromise. I don't need to be right. I just need to get to the right answer. And I'm very open to and have always been very flexible about making changes that are feasible in the context of the other stakeholders and factors that will make or break the project. So what did I miss?
That's good. Visibility. Now, Freeway, I will say, to answer your question about the what house was that taken from on the hill, that was a Google Earth image that was taken from the backyard of one of the houses on the hill. My architect is all gated, so they were not able to get back there.
Right.
But,
yes. Also, to the question of on the freeway signage, the architectural element facing the freeway was part of the architectural package that the city requested. To the extent that, you know, Commissioner Smith pointed out that there will be a sound wall that could potentially block the Sports Authority signage, I have a terrible short-term memory problem, and I'm not sure I'm going to remember that when this meeting is over. Again, as I said, I'm doing my best to make this project work, given the various factors. What can I answer for the commission?
Stephen, I just had a general question. You know, the nature of this process, as, by the way, thank you very much for everything you've done to accommodate the request for architecture throughout the process. I think in the end it'll serve both the city and the
Agreed.
Center very well.
Agreed. Bless you.
The nature of the process means that we have a lot of conversations about the disadvantages that this project enjoys with respect to signage and location. Just out of curiosity, what are the advantages of this site when you're talking to potential tenants? Why are they interested in this site?
The absence of other available mid-box locations in the city of San Clemente. The heavy traffic at the Trader Joe's is highly indicative of a strong market demand, and there's no question that the city of San Clemente is a wonderful place to do business. There's no question that those are all tremendous advantages, and I think that you know, it really comes down to supply and demand. And in this case, there's such a limited supply that even though the demand for retailers to expand has diminished over time, there is still demand for retailers to fill holes in markets that they currently don't have locations. And where you have a unique situation of such limited supply and customer demand and customer leakage to other markets, the retailers certainly recognize that, and we're dealing with very high-quality retailers. You know, we're dealing with retailers who are reasonably calculated to be around for the long term, or else we wouldn't be dealing with these retailers. We're very, you know, we're definitely students of retail, every bit as much as we're students of real estate development, and even then, we're constantly learning.
Okay. Jim, you have a... Thank you, Stephen. I appreciate it.
You're very welcome.
Yeah. And thank you. That was a very informative and well-done presentation. I appreciate it. And I agree with you. I think that this project is the architecture of it and, you know, kind of reigniting this area is going to be, you know, great for you, I hope, and certainly great for the city. It's all real good stuff. A couple of little questions about some of the signage. Regarding the freeway sign, mm-hmm. Have you or your client done any assessment and looked at, well, if we have the freeway signage, we would expect to get X amount more business, or if we don't have it, we'll get X amount less, something like that?
So the
Sports Authority is, so if you notice, Sprouts and Steinmark don't have and are not requesting freeway signage. And their feeling on that is they have very good signage to Camino de Estrella, and they have a great parking field. And basically, from the standpoint of their basic criteria for site development, the site checks out. They don't have any negatives for their development. For Sports Authority, because of the impacted parking field, because of the grade differential, because it's tucked into a corner, from Sports Authority's standpoint, there are a number of factors that cause the Sports Authority. There are two teams in the retailers. There are the real estate guys, and there are the operators. The real estate guys want to make the deal. They always want to make the deal. That's an overstatement, but they want to make the deal. And then the operators come in and have to make a pass judgment on whether the operators will be able to succeed at the site. And the operators have made a very strong point that without the freeway signage, given the other factors that are on the site, that, you know, and given that their front signage doesn't have their red background and isn't going to be more visible from Camino de Estrella, that they would rather pass on this site and wait to see what happens with the Staples box, or wait to see what other opportunities come up, because it's a balancing test. It's not an all or nothing to one issue. And in fact, that's why, we had come in originally, as Sean and Jim recall, we wanted a 50-foot pylon sign, a multi-tenant pylon sign at the freeway, and they disabused us of that notion and encouraged us in terms of architecture on the building for the one tenant who really is impacted. And we were able to successfully sell that to the tenants. And again, for Sprouts and for Steinmart, because of all of the benefits of the site, that outweighed the detriment of not having the freeway sign, the freeway visit, freeway signage that they have in other projects that we've done with them have freeway signage. It's almost unheard of. It's more unusual than not for these tenants to make deals without freeway signage. But when it came to Sports Authority, because of the other impacts to the site, and again, if this were a single tenant building, the two-thirds of the building, if you will, outweighs the one-third of the building. But when the building is being subdivided into three, the tenant who is stuck, if you will, at the east end of the building, so this signage is what gets the operators comfortable that in light of the benefits of coming to San Clemente, in light of, you know, the market leakage to other markets, in light of what's going on with the entire shopping center, that Sports Authority can make the deal. So it's a long-winded no.
Okay.
To your original question.
No, thank you. No, I appreciate
the
precision.
But I wanted to give you
precision.
Context.
Yeah.
Well, because it's a balancing test. It's not a clear, there isn't a, I couldn't honestly give you a clear-cut answer without elaborating on the factors that would be involved.
No, I appreciate it. And it's pretty clear that the evidence we have is that they have, their professional judgment is that they have these concerns. So, and what about any safety assessment, either from the on-ramp there that we might see that from, or from I-5 going north? Has there been any assessment or statement to that effect on the impact of the sign?
Associated with the negative declaration that was prepared, I can tell you that I was in contact and was reviewed by Caltrans, and they indicated that they have no concerns regarding the wall-mounted sign.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Fani?
Yes, back to the wall, the size of the lettering on the side of the wall facing the freeway. Since we are widening the freeway, the signage will then be closer to the vehicles driving up because the freeway will be closer to the signs. Was there any ratio adjustment in the size of the lettering performed to accommodate this change?
We brought the sign down from 8 feet to the 7 feet 4 inches.
To accommodate the widening of the freeway?
Because, I mean, the As it is, when we look at the Sports Authority sign from the freeway, it is not very visible other than from very few perspectives. There are about four or five perspectives that we brought into the city to show, and this is, I think, the most visible, if we look here, that the sign would be. To shrink the sign any more would make it invisible to a point that I just don't know that I could convincingly make the argument to Sports Authority or that Sports Authority would believe that their sign would still be visible. And again, if what Commissioner Smith has told us comes to fruition, it will be irrelevant.
Did you say that they signed the lease for a 15-year lease 2 months ago?
I'm sorry?
Did you say that
they
signed?
No, I said that Sprouts signed its 15-year lease about 3 months ago. Sports Authority signed its lease less than a month ago. At most, it was a month ago. I don't remember exactly, probably 3 to 4 weeks ago.
And how long is that lease for?
That lease is a 10-year lease.
10-year lease. Thank you.
You're very welcome.
Okay. Are there any other questions?
I have a question for Sean, briefly, on our freeway signage ordinances, et cetera. Why we have an exception here, but I noticed the shopping center across the freeway has about 11 or 12 freeway signs. That those were grandfathered to that shopping center?
Yeah, those were done, I do not believe, in the 90s. I believe they were there in the 80s, because I'll be honest, I remember seeing those when I was camping as a small child down at San Clemente State Beach in the 80s. So,
way to make the rest of us feel old, Sean.
I've just given you context. They have been there for a while. So they have been there for some time.
Okay, so they're grandfathered as the
yes.
vendor turnover.
I think they did get a sign exception when they came in.
Okay, because I just noticed
it has been a long time.
They're current. I mean,
yeah,
if you look up the Hobbit.
Hobbit did receive consistent with their sign program, but they went through a process in which a master sign program was approved, and whatever requirement back in that was required at that time, which I'm assuming as our sign program has had little modification actually since the 1983 code.
Okay.
I'm guessing that
it went
through a very similar
process. I
counted
there today, and I think there's 11 signs or something like that.
There are a number of signage both there and on the adjacent shopping center as well.
Okay,
the applicant would be agreeable to increasing its signage to be more consistent with the project across the way if the commission would prefer. We're very flexible.
Bonnie?
When they're finished, I have a slide that I wanted to go over.
Oh, okay. Sean. When we're in discussion, then okay.
More questions for Sean.
Oh, okay.
With the Sean.
All right. Stephen, I have a question for you, and I think Sean has shared my question with you earlier today. I know they wouldn't be happy, but would the applicant or would the tenant be open to changing that sign to a bronze tone that was more compatible with the architecture? I ask this because in my tenure as a planning commissioner, which has been 8 years, I only recall one freeway sign exception permit that we've granted, and it was for Holiday Inn, and they preferred the green of their logo, but we had asked them to change to the bronze.
So if it was my decision, I would say we could accommodate that. But because it's ultimately Sports Authority who's going to decide, I called the head of real estate for Sports Authority today and pushed him on it. And his response was that he has so much pushback internally that they didn't get the red background with the white lettering for their sign, and pushback internally over not getting the lighting of the letters for their sign, that to go this route, he just doesn't see that it would be feasible to keep this deal alive from their standpoint. I didn't want, given the gravity of the question, I didn't want to guess, even though I thought I knew the answer to the question. I did make sure to call the head of real estate and probe him on this. You know, one of the conditions I also checked with him was the condition that the lights would be turned off by 10 p.m. And that he agreed, if he has to live with, he can live with. But this is one that he told us he can't live with.
Okay, that's helpful information. Thank you.
You're very welcome.
And I think maybe if you'll trade places with Sean, because I think Commissioner Barnes has some questions. Thank you.
Do you want your other?
Have you got that slide? Thank you. Okay, this brought into question for me on page 4 and 5 of what we were given to study, in which precipitated me calling Sean and asking for some other images. But what we actually have to compare for the size of the signage was one building project on the top, and then a different one with different dimensions on it, and the one in the bottom. And they should really both have been the same, so that we could compare the size of the lettering on there with the size of the building as it would be. Now, in talking with Sean, it was discovered that there was a design change afterwards, so the upper one was the original design, and the one on the bottom is the new design. But what we really need, that what would be so helpful for commissioners, is if the city would require the applicant to provide the two same project images with the comparative different sizes of signs on them, so that we could tell. So all I had at the time, I took my ruler, and if we look at the Sprouts, for example, by comparison, the building on the bottom measures 1.5 inch wide, and the diagram on the top for the same thing is 1 inch. So that means the bottom one is 50% wider. It's a much bigger building. You measure the angle of the rooftop, it's 3/4 of an inch on the bottom one, which is more than the 1/2 inch on the top one. So we're looking at, on the bottom one, we have the standard signage, which is smaller, on a much bigger building, one that is perhaps 50% larger than the one on top. So yes, it's going to look smaller in proportion. And it also, you know, doesn't help that the top image is in color. It's got colored tiles on it. It has shading. It has trees. It has 3D dimensions on it.
Bonnie, did you have a question for staff? Because otherwise I think this would be better.
No, I need to finish this. We need to request our applicants to please submit 2 like images for comparisons of signs in the future. So I wanted to thank Sean for at the last minute providing the other apples to apples images. And if you want to put that on the screen, the one that Sean provided, we can now look at that one with the questions. He added that this afternoon.
I got it.
Thank you, Sean. So Sean provided 2 that were now the same size, and this is the actual new design, and which helps us see the differences in the sizes. So in the future, it would surely help us if we could have applicants provide this for us. At least it would for me. And the concern I have with this is that there are approximately 14 other businesses in the center, and they have standard size signs on them. So would the overall appearance be more harmonious if they all of the signs were in compliance with the zoning code? That would be my first question for discussion. Was I didn't see anything about that in the report.
As I mentioned earlier, this is just phase 1. There is going to be a phase 2 following up. Consistent with how we reviewed the architecture, there was a phase 1 with the architecture, which was the Kmart Center, which is trying to move forward sooner with the development of the Sprouts facility and the other improvements on the site. And then phase 2 came, it's going to include the TJ Maxx and other various retailers. The signage, as was the architecture, is going to follow this pattern. So in terms of, I would say, the scale, and we talked about this in DRC, in terms of the scale and proportionality and design components, in terms of, again, really focusing on fitting within the proportionalities we have, the signage for that phase two will ultimately, for the major tenants, probably look very similar to what you have here on the wall signs. Again, fit proportionally to those places. It may not be this. It may not be 8 foot. It may not be 6 foot. It may be 7. It may be 7.5. I don't know. We have not gotten that, but it will be in scale and character with this proposal, as well as we'll be evaluating on the other tenants on the opposite side facing the Camino Maricosa, as well as the two standalone facilities. Those designs will be, all the signage will be designed consistent, again, with those spaces, as well as consistent with the materials and the illumination as proposed here with phase one, if approved.
Okay, the next one has to do with wayfinding. Due to the technology that we have today, such as GIS apps on our smartphones, mega signs on storefronts are not as imperative for wayfinding. And I was wondering if there was any thoughts about this, especially compared with the very nice, large, three high-quality monument signage that is going in at different points, the three different points showed on your diagram.
Again, staff's concern had to do with proportionality, scale, and design. And so in reviewing the smaller 64-square-foot sign versus the larger sign, staff felt in terms of the utilization of space, proportionality of white space versus signage, location on the buildings, and as well as visibility of those signs taking away being too small as viewed from the public right-of-way, staff felt that in terms of a design-wise proportionality and scale, it was actually more appropriate in terms of the look and feel of the site, design-wise in terms of compatibility with the architecture at the larger size rather than the smaller.
All right. If we could please put back the image of showing the row of the Sports Authority over it. Thank you. That's fine. Does this pass the test of the law of unintended consequences? So when we approve master signages that will be going into the future uses, this particular land area and shopping center has had numerous businesses that have changed hands over the years and have not stayed. And if another business replaces one of these, according to Sean, it has the same right to the same large size, and only administrative approval is needed. Is that right? Is that what you told me today?
Yes, it is consistent with the locations and sizes as approved by the Planning Commission as a condition of approval that the master sign program will be updated to reflect just the locations of the signage if it were to be approved this evening. Yes, all it would need if a tenant were to come out and change, for example, let's say Sprouts were to leave. If a new tenant were to go into Sprouts, they would be limited to the sign locations on where Sprouts is located in terms of that box and in terms of square footage. And it would just require administrative sign permit and building permit.
And we also have to adhere to the same kinds of sign materials,
yep,
and
lighting,
quality.
Illumination, that's correct.
All right then, so what if a cigarette wholesaler came over and into the Sports Authority building there, would you want a mega sign there? Would you want a large sign facing the freeway? Would you want a sign that could be seen from the homes that you showed in these other slides, if it was a cigarette wholesaler?
I don't think that's a question for staff.
I don't think it's appropriate for us to discuss the content of the signs.
Future unintended consequences.
We have to look at the future businesses and how this would apply to the future development.
But you can't judge, and the city attorney can expand on this, but you can't judge the criteria of the sign based on potential content of the sign, only on the impacts of the signage itself in terms of aesthetics to the center.
So the question is that what you want? You want that option to happen. That's my question. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Do you have a question of Sean?
Yeah, I have one of Sean and one of the applicant.
Okay. All right. Sorry. So when you come back up, you can bring up whatever issue it is you were. Go ahead, Jim.
Sean, to get back for a moment to the sign on the bottom.
Yes, sir.
I wasn't aware there was going to be the retaining wall there on the on-ramp. Do we have an idea of the height of that retaining wall, and if we could just imagine it superimposed over that lower image, what it might, how high it might go?
You know, I don't. I actually did not know. I was more focused on landscaping in my conversation. I could probably get an answer to that if I were to have a few minutes, but I do not have an answer to that at this exact moment, no. I may be able to get an answer, but again, I can't guarantee you.
Are you talking about the potential sound wall?
Yes.
Yes, I mean.
Michael, you said you looked at the plans. Would you be able to?
No, I didn't say that. Oh, okay. I happened to go over this with Tom Bonnigan because the sound wall is a big issue, short list, really big issue. And I was pleased to see that this sound wall is being added where it is existing today due to the widening. And pleasantly surprised by that, actually. And it goes all the way to Vaquero. It doesn't go across the bridge, but it's pretty well continuous from from the beginning of Estrella all the way to, I would say, the Vaquero Bridge. And as I understand, that'll be a continuous sound wall, height unknown. So I don't know how high that'll be, but judging from the sound walls that you can see out there, one could assume that it may screen the backside of that building substantially. Yeah, certainly if you're on the closer side of the freeway.
Yeah, I think it's relevant here. I wasn't aware that was going up. I did notice on the other day when I went by the site, I drove by it a number of times, the falsework walls they have up there actually obscure quite a bit of that right now. I'd actually like to know what the plans are for that in terms of that, because it could, you know, it could turn that freeway-oriented sign into a wall-oriented sign. So that's a question that I have for that. So anyway, I'd like to know what that is if we can. But I know I'm asking you sort of at the last minute. So
I can try to make contact, maybe perhaps during the next question to see. Like I said, no guarantees, but I will do my best.
No, I got it.
Because I didn't remember seeing the sign, seeing walls on the on ramps. But it's been a while since we've looked at the plans. So it'd be interesting to know.
So I knew there was landscaping, and that's why I purposely.
The signs are either less likely to occur or lower in height. In situations where the topography is such where it's sunken down, there's less need for sound protection when you're below the freeway than when you're above it. So there may or may not be as tall of a wall. And I've looked at it, and it's been a long time, too, and I can't remember where they started again.
That EIR was like
and the heights
years
can
ago.
Go from anywhere from, you know, 8 feet to quite a bit larger, like 20 feet in some cases. So it's hard to say. If it were a higher one, it certainly would impact the sign, but if it were the more standard 8-foot size, it probably wouldn't have any impact at all from the main view, which is the other side of the freeway.
Okay, thank you, Jim.
So I have a question of the applicant as well. I forgot to ask this earlier. The small text signage on the sprouts, I see that sometimes on grocery stores. You know, it says pharmacy or fresh produce, what have you. What's the purpose of that signage?
To inform the customer of the different departments within the grocery store. And it's part of their brand identity as well.
They have that on all of their grocery stores across.
No, yeah, I understand. I'm just trying to see what it's communicating. And
that's the purpose. And also, given the width of that gable, I'm sorry for interrupting.
Mm-hmm. Sorry.
Given the width of the gable, too, it just seems to balance things out nicely as well. Sprouts also, is six. The letters are 6.5 feet tall relative to, Steinmark being 7 feet and Sports Authority being 7.5 feet. So Sprouts is giving something up to, you know, for those to departmental identifiers as well.
Okay. It also highlights their entry doors. There's one above each actual.
That's an excellent point, Sue. Thanks.
Oh, those are the actual entry doors.
Those are the entry doors as well.
Okay. Very good.
I just wanted to, first of all, I was very happy to see that there was a comparison plan, Commissioner Barnes, that was to scale. There was no intent to provide different plans, and I'm happy to see that was remedied. I want to point out that as it relates to the the Burnham site. So again, we have no business relationship or co-ownership or anything to do with the Burnham site other than we're happy to develop cooperatively. Based on, you know, whereas each of our tenants are, 30,000 square feet, or at least 30,000 square feet, the Burnham site will have one tenant that may be as large as 25,000 square feet, which is currently contemplated for TJ Maxx, and their next major tenant is likely, or they're speaking with Ulta Cosmetics, which is only a 10,000 square foot tenant. So while there are a number of other tenants, the square footage of those tenants drops off precipitously. And after that 10,000 foot tenant, the numbers we're talking about are for much smaller operators. So from a scale standpoint, I think that there really is a distinction. And the other point I would make, too, is that, and this is an important point, that, you know, as much as we try to tell retailers, what they need and what they don't need, they have this frustrating habit of telling us that they know better than we do. And really, when it comes to, in terms of the size of the importance of their brand identity and their signage, things evolve over time. You know, I think your point about GPS is an excellent one. But the retailers aren't there yet. I'm not sure if the customer is there yet. I think ultimately, when cars drive us to destinations without us driving, which will probably happen by next year or the year after, it may be that the retailers view signage differently. But as we sit today, notwithstanding the compelling nature of your point, it's the retailers don't take it as compelling. And at the end of the day, without the retailers, we don't have a project.
Stephen, I had a quick question.
Sure.
Sean might have run this one by you as well. Do you have an objection? We've had experience in the past where smaller signs, such as the ones that are over the two entrances for Sprouts, that they've been placed too close to the arches, mm-hmm. and so just architecturally it's not appealing. If we added a condition of approval, are you open to
yes.
that just requiring that there's enough clearance?
Yes.
Okay.
I've
Thank
been
you.
Waiting to say yes all night, so yes.
All right, Michael, you had a question of Stephen?
No, actually, I have a question for the Design Review Committee.
Oh, okay. You want to wait till we get to discussion for that?
I can, sure.
Okay. All right. Any further questions of the applicant or staff? Okay, thank you very much.
You're very welcome. Thank you.
All right. At this point, we'll open the public hearing and invite anyone who wishes to speak to this issue to step forward. Seeing no one step forward, I will close the public hearing and invite discussion. And what I'd like to do after Michael asks his question, in order that we move through this in an orderly way, since we have two different resolutions before us, and really three different issues to evaluate. I'd like to start with our discussion focused on the monuments, and then we can move on to the other issues. I think it just might help us to have a more interactive discussion and reach resolution more quickly. So, but Michael, did you want to ask about DRSC first? Or
well, yeah, but it's not about the monuments. It's about the building side.
Oh, okay. So if you don't, do you mind waiting until we
no,
get to
No, I don't.
The,
sure
okay.
So I was able to reach out to Mr. Bonnegut, and he informed me that there is no sound wall at the ramp, but there is an existing sound wall to the south of it that is going to be rebuilt, just to the south of the on-ramp.
Did he say how high?
He did not say how high. I asked him, but, you know, he's checking these plans from, I believe, home, and so he was doing me a favor to respond back here. So
there was an existing one to be rebuilt.
There, I believe they were pretty tall.
The same height?
Yeah, and I would guess they were at least 10 feet tall.
In fact, that's supposed to be a test section with the new material.
Extensive sound wall where there's none today.
Yeah.
When you're driving.
Right, but I'm not sure. It sounds like there's not going to be an additional sound wall added to the on-ramp.
That is not at the on-ramp, no, it sounds like, from the information I just received. But it does sound like that, yeah, right.
That actually goes past the Sports Authority sign. You see, the on-ramp doesn't end until here. But the walls don't begin until after the on-ramp.
I believe what he said, there is no new wall.
Views, you know, heading north from a certain distance, you might potentially block it.
I do believe, though, there is, again, and it's just from familiarity with the exit, I believe that there is some kind of wall here protecting these residents. Mm-hmm. And I believe that, as I said, if that's gone right now, that I believe that's probably what he's referring to will be rebuilt here. But he said there is no new wall proposed in this location, is my understanding. That's what I've been trying to interpret from the information I just received. But I know that there is, just again, trying to remember out there, some kind of wall there in front of those homes, and that's right there adjacent to that back corner. And I've also, just to let you know, staff has gone out, and the edge of this facade here is past this building, so this sign will not have any kind of impact with to the residential area there, especially with the halo illumination.
Okay. Thank you, Sean. Appreciate that information. Okay. Commissioners, do we have any thoughts about the monuments? Any issues you'd like to raise for discussion? I'm sorry, Wayne. Go ahead.
I really have no issues with the monument signs. I think they're fine. I think this shopping center needs everything they possibly can get, to say the least. In my past career, I managed shopping centers and office buildings for investment trusts throughout the country. And I'm a certified property manager. And I must say, this shopping center has had a real bad history, very problematic history, and this shopping center needs all it can get. So I'm in favor of the monument signs, unless there's some refinements from someone that has some suggestions.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Don?
I'd like to echo Commissioner Eggleston's comments there, that I think the shopping center needs all it can get, and I have no issues with the monument signs. I think, once again, I agree with Sean's brief on the proportionality versus the size of the mall and the center. And so I think the monument signs, although slightly larger than normal, do meet the proportionality issues that he points out. And I think I think I was heartened by the comments from DRSC and your notes on this subject also. So I have no issues with the monument signs.
Okay, thank you. And was it Jim? Were you next? Or?
I think so.
Okay.
I think I'm usually very reticent about monument signs. I think we've probably offered too many in the city, and I think it's actually a pretty high bar that you need to have a monument sign. But I do think in this case I agree with some of the other commissioners. Over 100 yard setback is a long way to go, even though some of the main signs are you know, reasonably large, could probably be seen by the street. I think it's just the characteristics of the building. It's kind of a, in my eyes, sort of a classic example of why you would need a monument sign. I was a little hesitant at first with the 10-foot size as opposed to 6-foot size, but it's set back 10 feet from the street. I would also prefer all the same color, but you know, I think, yeah, with again, with the retail, with this particular retail outlet, I think having them with their choice of colors, they're not going to have logos. You know, I think I can be pretty content with that. So even me, who's usually resist monument signs, I'm also in favor of those monument signs.
Okay, thank you. Michael?
Yeah, when I looked at the design of the monument signs without any knowledge really of specific setbacks, I was very concerned that they were too big and they could be blocking people making turns and not seeing the traffic coming. But Sean clarified that with a 10-foot setback, and I think that's plenty to open that view corridor up. So I feel really good about the fact that even though these are, I think, pretty large monument signs, that the setback is going to keep them from being a safety concern.
Thank you. Okay, Bart?
Yeah, I'd like to thank the applicant for working with us on these signs from the design review perspective, and I'm pleased with what's happened. The traffic along Estrella is going to be relatively slow with the stoplight and all, and these signs aren't going to have to compete with any other signs in the area since it's the only commercial property there, so I don't think we need to worry about a proliferation of signs. So it'll just be these two limited on Estrella, and I'm very comfortable with it.
Okay, thank you. Bonnie?
I'm comfortable with it as well, especially the high-quality materials and the backlighting with the halo lighting, so that it's not as contrast and glaring. So I'm in favor of this as well.
Okay, thank you. I'm supportive of the signs as well. I just wanted to thank Bart for his suggestion that the applicant consider a smaller sign for the first entryway. I think that was a definite improvement. And also, Sean, thank you very much for putting the comparable signs in our packet. That was very helpful. I went out with a tape measure and checked some of them because I thought that, you know, the one that where Griffin Optometric is, that had to be like 6 feet, and it was eight foot eight. And so after having stood next to a number of the signs, I also feel comfortable with the sign height. So it looks like when we get to voting that will be unanimous. All right, and then how about we discuss the signs, the wall signs along the Estrella frontage, and I believe, Michael, that's where your question for DRSC comes in.
Yes, thank you. But I'd like to clarify something for Commissioner Barnes. When we were talking there about the monument sign, you mentioned the halo lighting, and I believe that's not the case. These signs are going to be lit from below with an exterior lighting. Mm-hmm. So they're not going to be halo lit.
That's a good, important clarification.
Yeah, I just want to make sure you understood that.
Thank you.
The question I have about the signage really deals with the Design Review Committee, that on the graphic that we're now looking at with the Sports Authority and Steinmart and Sprouts, assuming that this is the drawing and the scale that you all looked at, is this the size that you felt comfortable with and approved?
We don't actually approve things. We give recommendations to the commission, but I was comfortable with it. It is on the large size, but I can live with that because of the distance from the street and we took away a lot of the branding, like on Sports Authority, by getting rid of the big square red thing and all. And, you know, driving by the site, tenants want to know, well, I shouldn't say that. The tenants want to know that people are not necessarily turning in to go there, but are subconsciously realizing that they are there. And I think for that to occur with these buildings, this is probably necessary, and I would approve the size of the signs after their corrections to what we had commented on in the design review.
And the reason I said that is that I wanted to make sure that, yes, that was the recommendation of the design review. But also, I was a little bit alarmed at the discussion of the two different size elevations and the size of the letters, because that's pretty disconcerting, especially when you looked at the Sprout sign. So I just want to reconfirm the comfort level there.
Jim?
Yeah, well, looking at the Sprout sign, I think, and you gathered from my question, I had a bit of a concern of the extra two little signage things there. But my concern with that and what provoked the question is just the fundamental truth that the more signs there are, the less each sign means, and the more difficult it is to interpret or pick out, you know, an individual one. So less is usually better in that kind of case. I mean, we hear it from our traffic engineer, for instance. You know, he says no one pays attention to signs because there's so many traffic signs there. Same is true for, you know, usability and software engineering and things like that. But I think if I'm, you know, that extra, even with that extra signage, I believe the total square footage of the signage is still less than what they have by right in that area. And I'm right about that, yeah. So even with that, they're still coming in under the totals. And there's something to be said for familiarity. A lot of grocery stores have that. It almost is like a signal that it's a grocery store. So, you know, I the more I think about it, the more comfortable I am with that and leaving that. I think the proportion of the Sprout sign works very well you know, itself, I don't think it's too big. I don't think it's too small. Looking at just the 64-foot square foot limit that they have, it would be much too small for the architecture. It wouldn't fit. It definitely looks awkward. The Sports Authority sign, I think, is about as big as it can be, at least that I'm comfortable with. I know that the Steinmart sign apparently is smaller now than when you looked at it in DRSC. I wasn't at that meeting. But it still feels a little too large to me. There's white space above and below the signs on either side of it. But in Steinmart, there's no white space. And I know that is one reason for that is the, you know, the nature of the architecture of the facade. It's just, you know, higher facades. But I have a little problem with it. I'm still struggling. I want to hear what other people have to say about it. I'm still struggling a bit with that particular one, because I know it's in terms of height anyway, it's larger than the other signs. So I want to hear what other people have to say about that. But certainly in terms of the Sports Authority and the Sprout sign, I'm pretty comfortable with those at this point. I'm glad that DRSC has gone through and made the changes that they did.
Okay, thank you, Jim. Don?
Yeah, I comment that thank you, Sean, for putting the entire DRSC package in our notes. That's always useful because I could see the was to is. What work that you two did as far as encouraging them to get things in better proportionality. And so when you think about a 30,000-square-foot building, now with all the architectural visions that we have that have been brought forth through the efforts of the actual building that we've previously approved, I think to look at a 30,000-square-foot building with this type of architecture with a total of basically five signs, three large ones and then two entry monuments for the market. You know, I'm comfortable with it. I think the DRSC has done a good job. When I look at this, the 300, when I was toward the site again today for about the third time over a weekend, and you look at the drop down of the top topography ticked to the left, and the 350-foot setback, I think this is good proportionality. I think that this is something that I can live with. And I would almost key off one of Commissioner Ruhlman's comments. There's beauty and simplicity of what's shown here. So I'm leaning back to Commissioner Eagleson's initial comment that this shopping center needs all the help it can get. And so I'm pretty comfortable with what has been brought forward to us tonight.
Thank you, Don. Bart?
Yeah, I just want to say Jim brought up a very good point. And, Sean, I've got a quick question for you. If they were to stay to the small square footage, even though they're three tenants, how many signs could they have?
How many signs that they could have? Each tenant, well, once they get up to four signs for the site, it requires a master sign program. They can have, in terms of signs, I do not have the sign code. I know that they cannot
exceed.
Oh,
just a guess. I'm not going to hold you to a number. But
I don't
it's
know.
Multiple
if
the, signs.
What I'm trying to remember is that if there's a limitation, I know it's a square footage limitation. So there's a total square footage facing in a single direction, and then the total square footage for the site. And so they're well below at each of it. I believe I wrote in here for the site, they're allowed to have up to.
It's nine something.
986 square feet, and they're proposing 868.
Yeah,
so
I just wanted to.
Yeah, again, they're over 120 square feet below what they could maximum out, and that includes the monument signs.
No, I just want to say that I think the solution we have is far superior to the multiple signs they could have by right.
Okay.
Bonnie?
It's hard to see.
Yeah,
I should have a flashing light.
Cookies were in the way.
I'm supportive of the facade signs. I do have a question with regard to Sports Authority, though. I think it's a rather difficult to read, and I just wondered if there could be more space between the sports and the authority so that it could be read better. But, of course, that's going to be a bigger sign. But it just seems to me that it's hard to read.
And I can answer that for you.
Yes.
Because I could tell you that their brand police would say absolutely not. Mm-hmm. They think it reads wonderfully that way, and any alteration, I mean, the applicant can confirm this, but any alteration of their logo, even if it's improving it, would be
I know that, but I just, it's just hard.
I agree with you. It's a very awkward logo.
It is. And I do agree with you, Julie, about the Sprouts to have the other auxiliary signs spaced differently. But I'm very supportive of that. I mean, I look at it from the road, from Camino Estrella, by the way. It's not Estrella. It's Estrella. It's difficult to see anything in that shopping center because of the topography from the grade down and way back there. It's just so difficult to see. And this is, I think, a good solution here to this.
Well, maybe Stephen will forward our comments to the brand police at Sports Authority, and they can improve the logo because it, no, I'm just kidding.
May I make a comment?
Yes, sure.
If by spacing it, assuming they would approve spacing it to make the sign more legible, and I wouldn't want to opine definitively without checking with them, would that be permitted without it being deemed greater sign area? In other words, if there could be a condition that says subject to staff review, if, you know, we can certainly look at, I mean, your point is, I think, is a very good point, that I think that this is what they gave us.
Right.
But I'm happy to suggest to them, why don't you have some more space that it might be more readable?
Would you like us to add a condition?
Anything from this evening?
I think adding a condition of that would be fine. I don't know what they'll say. When I was involved in shopping centers, they would not do anything like that. But I'm just asking, because I think when signs are that big and that from that distance, it's more readable than most of their shop. Most of their stores are closer to the road, and it's more readable if it's a little space between. Yeah.
Okay, Bonnie?
Well, my opinion of it is that they did such a fine job with the monuments, and that people will know what is in here when they drive up. And I'm thinking back when we had the Kmart, when we had the Sears, when we had the Big Lots, and it was very easy for me to see those signs that were on those facades. And so because the vibrant colors for Sports Authority and Steinmart and the others have been done so well, I think we would do very well to stay within the standards in the municipal code. And that would be my recommendation for tonight. Thank you.
So, Bonnie, so you prefer the 64 foot?
Yes, I do.
Okay. All right. And is that a philosophical issue, or is it would you be comfortable with a reduction in size of some percentage?
I would be comfortable with something in between, if it came down to that.
Okay, all right, that's helpful.
But I'm just remembering how easy it was for me to see the signage on the past, retail. Stores that were there for so many years. I had no problem.
Just to let you know that the past retail signs all had sign exceptions as well. So they were over 64.
I was going to ask, do we know how many square feet they were?
They were over 100. I can tell you that. I have it literally. The Kmart one sitting on my desk, and I know that was over 100 square feet. And then I don't have Big Lots what that size, but Mr. Petch is right that there was a sign exception.
Okay. All right.
If I could just actually respond to what you were saying, it's I know where you're coming from, and mm-hmm. I definitely know the feeling. I've in fact been the lone dissenting vote on sign exception permits, even very nice ones that otherwise were great. One of the reasons that I'm in favor of this is always something that I've had to learn to keep in mind is that they have this they're permitted a total signage, and it's actually quite common that the total signage they're permitted, the square footage that they're permitted, is larger than they could put on a particular facade. Mm-hmm. So that there's a certain right that they have, and if they don't put it on the facade, well, they could put it other places, you know, or potentially put it other places that aren't as appealing. And in fact, I believe the square footage includes a freeway sign, which we haven't talked about yet. So, you know, that's something to consider as well, is if you take this as a whole, even though these are each larger than 64 square feet, which, you know, usually is what I, you know, lean towards as well, it's significantly smaller than they have a right to in terms of what they do overall. So,
I just looked in the sign ordinance to confirm Mr. Crandall's question in regard to whether they could do multiple signs. And there's no regulation that permits the number of signs. However, Sean is correct that a sign program is required to be approved over four signs. So theoretically, you know, the aesthetics could be regulated if they wanted to do more than one sign per space.
It requires
the approval of a master sign program for the center, which you know, the primary thing you're looking at is aesthetics and design. So Commissioner Crandall does make a good point that they could conceivably do more than one sign per tenant space. However, we would still have the authority to review it to make sure it aesthetically, you know, blends in and doesn't detract from the architecture of the center.
And if I may, Commissioner Rulon, the square footage is consistent with the requirements of this code. That includes also the monument signage, the two monument signs, as well as also the freeway-oriented signage. It's in that total I provide, the 868 square feet.
Yes, Tom.
Yeah, I'd like also make a point that in future reviews sometimes applicants have been, we have actually negotiated smaller than what's been approved. And the first thing that comes to mind in that case was 24-hour fitness. And so we, by rights, when that building changed hands through the negotiations and the design review and deliberations here, that specific sign I remember right on Pico was, and they agreed to a smaller sign other than was allowed by right. So even though this sets and runs with the land, so to speak, and future turnover sometimes on occasion when it's brought to the commission for some approval, that signage can be reviewed. So I just point that out.
Michael, was your light on?
Yeah, I think my mic sign needs to be bigger. I've had that on for a while. Is it appropriate to talk about the freeway side yet or not?
We're almost.
Okay, well, I just want to say that from the furniture that we're looking at from Estrella, I think the signage is great. And I think that the fact that this is halo-lit signage is really even another step towards sensitivity. Makes a really big difference when you do halo lighting versus backlighting, can lighting, you know. And I know I've been in the business of doing a lot of signage in commercial buildings, and it makes a really big difference. And I think that the fact that we're getting that is a nice, softer, delicate touch. And I totally agree that signage is imperative. The project is set back from Estrella, and as somebody that lives in the hood, like I do, and I've seen the shopping center go through some different changes, all not so good, this is such a wonderful change that I think we want to do everything we can to support the success of that center, and I think that the signage that we're looking at on the building fronts here and in the monuments is totally acceptable to me, and I think it's going to make for a great project.
Bonnie, I understand where you're coming from, because I'm usually on the smaller side as far as what I'd like to see for signs. And actually, the project that Sean referenced in the staff report was one, the Target project. Initially, I really felt that the signs were too large, but when we discussed it in design review, you know, I came to look at it a bit differently because the proportionality, which is what Sean's been talking about tonight, just wasn't there with the smaller sign. So on that project, I shifted my opinion. On this project, I'm a little bit where Jim is. I'd like to see the Steinmart sign a tiny bit smaller, although I really like the directions or the direction that they've taken as far as moving a little more white space around the sign by adding that extra foot at the top and reducing the sign slightly. My concern isn't so much for Steinmart because, as we discussed in design review, the type style of their logo type is upper and lower case. My concern was more for the window that allowed for somebody who perhaps had a logo styled a bit more like Sports Authority. However, I don't feel so strongly about that I wouldn't support the project going forward. It's just it's more of a like than a have to have.
I got one question for Don. You brought up a real good point on 24-hour fitness. When we were negotiating, when we were reviewing that project, were we kind of playing off having a big sign towards Pico so they could have one on the opposite side rear?
I'm trying to remember.
Didn't we play some give and take on that?
I'm trying to remember that. It was a trade-off between one side and the other.
There were three signs proposed. One was on the rear, and I believe we denied that one. Mm-hmm. And then there was one on the La Pata frontage and one on the Pico.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we went back and forth balancing between the two.
Correct.
That's my memory.
Correct.
Is that right,
and
Jim?
It came to us because it was a change of use. So
They had an existing sign, kind of like what we're talking about here, they could have just used.
Right.
But they wanted to get a different, slightly different exposure by moving the sign.
That was it. They wanted to move it.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, then there was a little bit of give and take in terms of the other signage on site and the size of the sign.
The point being made that there's flexibility in the future sometimes, I guess, is the point I was trying to make.
Okay. That moves us. I haven't heard anybody say anything about the details in the master sign program. Michael, you've talked about the halo lighting and the fact that, you know, that's obviously a great approach. I think there might have been some discussion of the materials. Is everybody comfortable with the details of the way the master sign program is written?
Yes.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
I had one minor issue, but Sean assures me that the condition of approval that he has regarding not permitting logos will take care of that. I think there was one under item D, and I can't turn to that at this moment. Oh, here it is. Under item D, and I think this is in the current one, not the one from design review, but it did mention logos being permitted, but as the condition of approval is going to prohibit that, I guess that's not really an issue and doesn't need to be updated. Okay, that brings us to the freeway sign. And Michael, would you like to start us off?
Yeah, I'd like to start on that. I've got two problems with the freeway sign. First, I've got a problem in the fact that it was very controversial with the Marblehead project, and seeing how Marblehead is not going to have freeway signs on the back of the buildings, it seems hard for me to make an exception to put a freeway sign on this particular project. That's number one. Number two, honestly, I don't believe that the sign is going to be effective anyway. So with those two points, I'm really not very supportive of it.
Okay, thank you. Wayne?
I have a question for our attorney. You were not present here for the drag-out fight on Marblehead. I was on the city council at that time, and it was a real fight. The Planning Commission voted against it, as I remember. However, that when it got to city council, the majority of the city council actually designed the signs on the dais. But my question to you is, and I did not vote for that at that time. My question is, would this create a legal, not a judgmental precedent, but a legal precedent if we approved the Sports Authority sign?
Madam Chair and Commissioners, I'm thankful for the way that you phrased your question, because my answer was going to be it wouldn't create a legal precedent. There's nothing binding about the commission's action worthy to approve the freeway-oriented sign. Whether or not it creates a judgmentally-based precedent where someone could say, well, you approve this, therefore approve mine, it's a different question. But there's nothing legally binding about a discretionary action like this before you tonight.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you, Val.
Well, it was a drag-down fight for Marblehead, as we all remember, to say the least. I have driven past this site a number of times trying to find if I could see the sign, the proposed sign, going north, and I was not able to see it. You must have taken that photo from a truck or something, because
yeah.
It was way up, and I could not see the sign going north, and going on the ramp going south. I don't know how many people are going to turn their head like Linda Blair in The Exorcist to see the sign.
That's right.
But so I don't think it's going to be an effective sign, but that's up to Sports Authority to make that decision. Could you put the slide up about the how it would look from the development there?
No, let me get it for you here, Jim. I can do it for you. It's the only straight. No, it's all the way up. Keep going up.
Or
do you want it from the freeway, sir?
From the development right there. This is a gated community with homes that are $2 million plus. However, I was able to get in through the gate today since I'm an appraiser now, have an appraiser card, and actually went up to the up much higher than that, and thinking to myself, well, these homes higher up are going to be able to see that sign. But then I realized, guess what? They see the signs from Ocean View Plaza. And I thought, oh, well, that changes sort of my opinion on that, because if they can see the signs from Ocean View Plaza, they're certainly going to be seeing way in the distance a sign from Sports Authority. So I've gone back and forth and back and forth on this issue over and over again. Sometimes I was, you know, in the shower saying, having my speech prepared to deny it.
We don't want that visual effect.
No, we don't want that visual effect, though. Strike that for the record. But I know that when Marblehead finally develops, Steve Craig is going to come back to us once again with some requests for signage after he goes through the he has to go through what a some more legal wrangling. He has to. What was the judgment on that?
Their application was just basically reversed, so they can come back any time and submit for an application for a sign exception. Under center, there's nothing holding him back at this point.
Doesn't he have to have some further review about CEQA or something like that?
Well, they would have to go through the appropriate CEQA process this time. That was why it was the judgment against him was. And I think Mal knows a little bit about this, too, that the judgment had to do with the CEQA relying on an existing EIR from Marblehead, which didn't really take into account the true extent of the impacts of the sign exception.
Right.
So they were thrown out because they didn't have the proper CEQA process.
Right. The outcry that we got was not so much from people traveling on the freeway. It was from people across the freeway. And certainly at least I took that into account with my vote when we voted on that on City Council. But in this particular case, people from Seapoint can see the signs from Ocean View Plaza. They're going to be able to look in the distance and see the sign from Sports Authority, perhaps. But I am going to be supportive of the freeway sign. Now, people will probably faint on the floor when I say that, because I'm certainly, like Jim, very stringent upon signage. But I'm going to be supportive of the freeway signs.
Okay. Thank you, Wayne. Bonnie, were you next? Why don't you go ahead?
I think so. I'm just very supportive of comments by Mike Smith, Commissioner Smith. I have the same concerns, having gone through with the Marblehead issues and you know, whether the signs will be effective. And so I'm in agreement with Mike Smith.
Okay, thank you. And Bart?
I'm going to agree on a lot of cases with Wayne on this one. I don't like freeway signs. I don't want to set a precedence. But the people who drafted our sign ordinance must have anticipated something like this because they gave us discretion when the site is unique. And I want to make sure that if, in fact, it does get approved, it's stated that it's because the site is extremely unique and a tough site to deal with. I could not see the sign going south. I couldn't see the sign actually going north until I went up the ramp and was up on Estrella. So I don't think it has the same impact. It doesn't really serve like a freeway sign because it's not telling you, get off here because you've already passed it and don't have an exit to go to. So it's more just a reminder, a placeholder that it is here. And there is a shopping center in that area. So as much as I dislike freeway signs, I really like the fact we got some architecture on that parapet, and that profile will probably be seen from the freeway at some point, and I think that is a big plus rather than having that square parapet. And I'm in a position to support the freeway sign.
Okay, thank you, Bart. Okay, and Jim, or I'm sorry, Don, we
My light was failing, but so I finally got it. I don't know who was
first. Jim, why don't you go first?
No. Like others, I've been sort of on the fence about this or going back and forth a bit. I think the community makes it clear in the general plan and in our current sign ordinances that freeway signs are not a desirable thing. We've had people be taking down freeway signs. You know, gas stations, for instance, change the nature, some nature of their business. They're required to remove the signs. And when I look at the findings, you know, we have to find, for instance, the location of the site dictates the need for a freeway-oriented sign, for instance, and, you know, for this freeway-oriented sign. And while that corner does have its issues, we do have the monument signage, which I think is the purpose of that is to, you know, at least address part of those issues, of course. But does this sign, for, you know, whatever sign pollution it might add to on the freeway, does this sign increase the business identification? And I know the retail customer certainly believes strongly so, and I understand that. I understand they probably have business processes that just say, you know, perhaps, that say, you know, get as much signage as you can. That's understandable. But I don't see that. I don't see how it adds to, you know, how they're going to get businesses in more than what they have right now, you know, regardless of the issues that are there right now. You know, you could argue you can't see it very much, but if you can't see it very much, you know, what, you know, is it adding then to the business identification? So that's a finding that we have to make, that and of course each of us is going to have our own judgment on that, and that's something that I struggle with quite a bit. Like you say, there's no legally binding precedent, but we already have other signage close by that's grandfathered in, been there for many years, and yet it comes up in the hearing. If some other organization wants freeway signage, they will mention, hey, not too many years ago, you allowed freeway signage in this area. And obviously it's discretionary and there are reasons for it, but the conversation's going to come up. So we want to be careful and make sure, I think, that, you know, we're doing the right thing. Part of me wants to accommodate, you know, that tenant and that corner, but I'm kind of left with, you know, this is freeway signage. Freeway signage is a very special case in this city where you need the freeway signage to identify your business, and you can see the sign. There is some view of the sign on Estrella. There is, are the, actually three monument signs, right? Right, so there's going to be three monument signs that indicate that. You know, I agree, by the way, with the you know, with the mapping software and stuff. There's no bigger fan of that than me, and a lot of people use it, but, you know, things haven't caught up to that. We don't have anything in our, you know, in our findings that you know, allow us to rely on that, and I think there's still questions on how much that's actually used. So I don't want to enter that really into the conversation, at least in my thinking at this time. But you know, I just you know, it's a real close call. But for me, I'm looking at this and I'm saying, you know, it doesn't meet that finding. It doesn't we can't quite get to that bar. So that's my judgment on it.
Okay, thank you, Jim. Don?
Yeah, I can agree with Mr. Ruland's struggles, and it's close to the line. I think, similar to Commissioner Eggleston, though, I find myself slightly on the other side of the line. I think, you know, they want a freeway sign. It's going to possibly be very mute. There's only one angle you can look at it, and you're already committed to get off the freeway. Or if someone in the passenger seat sees it, you're already committed to going by it and having to really turn around and come back down the freeway. So I know freeway signs are a very sensitive issue in this town, particularly with Marblehead, and pole signs for gas stations or other pole signs that we've had huge fights over. But I think in this case, with this, the topography of this particular mall and the help it needs, that I would lean in favor of this particular sign. It's a very small sign. Its viewing angle is very limited. I don't know if Sports Authority, in reality, if they're going to get very much benefit out of it, but then again, there's 11 signs right across the freeway.
Okay. Thank you, Don. Bart, did you have something more? Okay. Bonnie?
Oh, I just thought that it would be so nice to have some more trees put in. So many have been taken out with this widening project. It would certainly add to the aesthetic appeal of our city, and I surely appreciate seeing that rather than signs along the side.
Okay. And Madam Chair, I would appreciate if when we vote on this, we could vote on the do the freeway sign as a separate vote.
Yeah, because we've got two different resolutions.
But one of the resolutions includes freeway signs, yes. And
right.
Can we do that way, Mr. Attorney?
It's a bit awkward, but it's possible to bifurcate those two actions within the sign exception resolution, if that's the commission's desire. We might have to come back with a second resolution to actually do that, because they are part of the same action, the same resolution. But that may require us to come back at a subsequent meeting to do that.
That's the way I would read it.
And if we did that, would that be a hardship for the applicant?
Yes.
Okay.
That would be a hardship, because we're running up against some dates that will affect whether the retailers
will be able to open in time for the holidays, for Thanksgiving this year. If the resolution is bifurcated, and there's simply an administrative second resolution, but if it's approved or disapproved separately, and then administratively it happens outside of this room, I think so long as the decision tonight is binding or is determinative, then that would be fine. I think it will be difficult. It will create a difficulty that I'm not sure how we would deal with if we were to have to come to another discretionary review for the separate resolutions.
Okay. Well, I will.
Jump in. What I would suggest you do is you take a straw vote on the two issues
and
figure out where you stand. Just in case staff did prepare an alternative resolution for denial of the freeway-oriented sign and the approval of the other sign. So we're prepared for that. If that's what the direction of the Planning Commission is, we can produce the resolution tonight with maybe some minor modifications depending on your direction. So we're prepared either way. I think the solution would be to do a straw vote so you can see whether you have a majority for one direction or the other, and then we can present the proper resolution to reflect that.
Yeah, so if we had three straw votes and that was recorded in the record, I would be quite happy with that. So.
Okay. Okay. I am, like the rest of you, I've gone back and forth on this issue. And in fact, I've gone back and forth on it several times sitting here tonight, which just goes to show you why the law in its wisdom requires us not to make our mind up until we've heard all the evidence and the discussion of our colleagues, because it does certainly impact our perception of the project and our opinions. I really don't like freeway signage. As I said earlier, the The only project that I have voted in favor of during my tenure has been one for a very, very difficult site, the Holiday Inn site, that most people can't figure out how to get there and have no idea that that it's there. But and that so that was very that I felt met the findings that it really required a freeway-oriented sign. I think that this site does as well. The topography, I think, which you mentioned, Don, I think is the unique factor here that some other projects that we have looked at in the past or may look at in the future might not share. It basically disappears down in that hole from the freeway, and you know, I with Wayne in saying that I don't know that the signage is really going to buy them anything because I don't think it's very effective. I too was sure that it was taken from a very tall truck, the visual simulation. So while I don't think that it will be a huge help to them, I think they need all the help that they can get. Because we'd hate to not see the center be successful. So I think based on the finding regarding adequate business identification and the unique aspects of the site, I would be able to be in support of the freeway sign. So even though I'd like to see it in bronze.
Madam Chair, could I interject?
Yes.
I was talking to Sean, and I apologize because I should have caught this sooner when I was reviewing the report. Sean informs me, my concern was that the uniqueness to make the findings if you decide to do the freeway-oriented sign exception really relies on that tenant space, that one tenant space for Sports Authority. But the actual conditions are such that they don't tie it necessarily to that tenant space. So I wouldn't
want. So it could be Sprouts if they.
Yeah, I wouldn't want the possibility that some later date that Sprouts, a new tenant, could come in and use the freeway sign and not be able to make the findings for that sign. So if you go that direction, I just would recommend that we add a condition that specifically ties, or also amend the resolution to specifically tie the freeway-oriented sign exception to that tenant space.
That's a good recommendation, because I think that would probably change how some of us would feel. Well, so then let's take a straw vote to see how many of us feel that this site meets the findings for a freeway sign tied specifically to that corner property. All who feel it meets the findings, please say aye. Aye. And all who do not?
No.
Nay.
No.
Okay, so that's 3-4. Pardon?
3-4 or 4-3?
4 in favor and 3 opposed. Thank you for the clarification. I don't think there's any need for us to bifurcate the resolution because I think Commissioner Rulin's request was that we just make it clear in the record where we all stood on that. So is there any need for any further discussion? Then perhaps we would have a motion.
Let me try the one on. You want me to do the. We have one we have to work on, right? That we're working on a resolution. Sean, are you working on words for that?
For 01, for the 0. For 15010, yes, but if you want to start with 15008, which was for the which is for the master sign program and the monument signs, it sounded like, and forgive me if I'm mistaken, but it sounded like there was general consensus regarding the monument signs and the master sign program, so perhaps start there. And I know that was brought up by Chair Darden regarding the potential of adding condition of approval 13 having to do with the small wall signs on Sprouts. I have some language prepared if the commission would be interested in hearing that language. I have the two wall signs above the entries of Sprouts shall be appropriately located to provide sufficient space between the top of the arches to the bottom of the signs. The intent is to ensure proper proportions in design now and in the future.
Okay.
And that would be condition approval 13.
Okay, I've got one question, and I think I know the answer, but I should probably ask it anyway. We haven't seen anything that Phase 2 is going to meet, and they're going to agree to this design program. Is there any way to somehow obligate or get a, I know the answer to it, but I thought we should at least ask it and find out so everybody knows, but I don't think there is any way to tie this sign program into the second phase within this development.
You know, I'm not that familiar with the second phase, but generally speaking, from a legal perspective, it's very difficult to tie this approval to an applicant who's not in the room with us today.
I can tell you.
And separate ownership, so that makes it even more difficult.
I can tell you that they are waiting to hear the results of this meeting, a meeting actually with the property owners on Thursday to discuss a variety of things, primarily which is them getting their signage, because they do wish to be right behind to get TJ Maxx and their other tenants in. And as I said, talking with them, they know that this, they have been in discussions with that and been part of this design, and they know that this is going to limit them moving forward, and they are supportive, as far as I've been told, so.
I got a question about that. Does that imply that they may want freeway signage?
No, there will be no freeway-oriented signage, and they don't have freeway frontage.
No.
This is a separate property owner. There is no freeway-oriented, there's no freeway portion of their property of Phase 2 that faces the freeway.
May I add something?
Yes.
As a practical matter, the tenants who are looking at the adjacent site have requirements in their leases that Sprouts, and either Sprouts and Steinmark are open and operating. These co-tenancy clauses are fairly typical in retail, and as a practical matter, the Burnham development will not, I mean, Mr. Burnham will be able to put in a Big Lots or Dollar Tree or Family Dollar, but he's not going to be able to attract a TJ Maxx or an Ulta or any of the other stronger retailers unless our project moves forward. And I say that only, and I didn't say that previously, I say that now, really in answer to the question about, I really believe, and I have reason to believe from discussion, that Burnham will go along with the same sign program, has no expectation of getting freeway signage if we didn't, and understands the Sports Authority freeway signage, and is, as a practical matter, they're very happy with this redevelopment, and really their development is really on hold pending the outcome of this development. So I think the practical answer is that they will go along. And we're also working together on sharing panels with each other. As you saw on each of the signs, the one furthest east, there was one out of the four panels allocated to the Burnham site at the main entrance. Three out of the six panels are being allocated to the Burnham site. And on the Camino Las Ramblas sign, it's also going to be, we're going to get the benefit of three of the panels, and we're sharing in costs. We're also sharing in the redevelopment of the parking lot together, so there's a very high level of cooperation for the benefit of the site.
No, I had a different.
Okay, thank you, Stephen. For staff, or?
Yeah, for staff. Something just occurred to me. If for some reason something goes south, or things are transformed again in the future someday in this area, and we end up having sort of a Big Lots store, go back to Kmart sort of a thing, I assume this would still allow those people to put freeway signage up in this area.
This,
is that correct?
This, the way I have tried to write this and condition this project is that these are for these tenants in these locations, or these, you know, breaking it up into three different sections, and similar to the condition that the city planner has recommended to tie the freeway-oriented sign towards just the one tenant in the corner in this condition, in that if it were to go back to one box, they would need to come back through, because the signage is located in these locations, in these sizes. Any modification to that, modifications down, we would not probably bring a sign, like there was a change in tenant for one of, let's say Steinmart became, a Best Buy. Let's say a Best Buy sign was smaller than that Steinmart sign, for just for throwing out a name. they would, you know, we wouldn't come back for that modification. But any kind of modification that would increase, modify, change any of these signs would have to come back before both design review subcommittee and this body.
Okay.
So if it goes back to a single tenant again.
I'm going to work with Mel on this. Sean can, you know, lead us off with a proposed condition. But I think that we need to state within that condition that given that the, you know, the required findings, you know, apply to the tenant space C or whatever it is, mm-hmm. that it is only to be utilized by that particular space and not any other
so you have that
tenant
right
space
now.
Within the center or an expanded space, something like that. So we, because, you know, arguably, if it went back to a solid big box, and I think our applicant even said this, then they have the visibility, mm-hmm. and then the finding goes away for the need. So I think we can craft the conditions so that it's very specific to the existing
space. So you're working on that
okay.
now?
We are.
Okay.
Are you working on that particular component? I have some.
I am working on that as of now.
Okay. Thank you, Mal. I have some initial language just regarding the freeway-oriented sign towards being only associated with that corner tenant. But again, perhaps we start with the other resolution if you want. Or it's up to the commission. I can provide you what I have to start with for the freeway-oriented sign if you'd like to hear it.
Sure. Please do.
So I have for condition of approval number 10. It would be the freeway-oriented sign shall only be utilized by the tenant space adjacent to the freeway. The intent is to ensure that this tenant utilizes the space that has the unique site conditions in order to approve the freeway-oriented signage.
Then we could add that other tenant spaces or the expansion of this tenant space would not qualify for the use of the
And that would trump the fact that this conditional use goes with the land.
That's exactly right. Yeah, the last thing that was just added ensures that if the presently, I guess, trifurcated, is that even a word, building went back to one big box, that language added would ensure that the freeway oriented sign could not be used for that big box retailer that comes in. It's only available with a tenant that has that one building to itself.
Well, is that to that tenant in that slice of the building, building C or whatever one you want to
major tenant 1C? For clarification. So I would agree certainly that if the Sports Authority space and the Steinmart spaces were to be combined into one, for instance, and certainly if it was one tenant like it was before, certainly the freeway signage would go away. And I would certainly agree that if the Sports Authority were combined with the Steinmart, that there would be that the substantial presence of that box would also be sufficient. The only concern I have is if, you know, retail is always evolving, that if there would be some adjustment where Sports Authority would want to increase by, say, 10,000 feet and Steinmart would go down by 20,000 feet, at what point do you draw the line? And the truth is, Steinmart is partially impacted here as well. But Steinmart is absorbing its impact because most of its frontage is not impacted. So and I was going to suggest that, you know, maybe the standard is that if the Sports Authority expands, you know, up to hits the point of 50% of the frontage of the Steinmart, and I just picked 50% out of thin air. So I mean. But you, as a conceptual starting place, and I'm open to refinement of that concept, but that so there is some flexibility built in because, for instance, you know, I believe, you know, just Sean mentioned Best Buy, that we're not, that 40,000 square foot Best Buys are going to be in the history books, and the Best Buys we're going to see are going to be 10,000 square feet. And, you know, Staples, any Staples that's 25 or 30,000 square feet,
any new staples today is about 12,000 square feet. So I would hate to be tied in to such a rigid framework that wouldn't, that there wouldn't be some flexibility, and we would have to annoy the Planning Commission with, you know, something that, so that there, if there wouldn't be some flexibility built into it. But I'm not asking to.
Couldn't it? Perhaps we could craft a condition to be more related to our intent, which is to have the freeway signage provide, basically based on the finding that a retailer that does not have adequate exposure. At such time that the size grows and their signage is clearly visible from Estrella, then that would negate the need for the freeway signage. So related more to the purpose of it rather than trying to figure out what the square footage and conditions are.
I would say keep it simple.
Yeah, if I can make a suggestion, which might go along those lines, it might be a little simpler. If they increase their size significantly like that, they would be moving and or increasing the size of their facade sign, so which would obviously give them a little more visibility from the street. Maybe it should just be worded that if the sign is moved or enlarged, then they don't get the freeway sign anymore.
I'm sorry.
No, you go ahead.
I'm so on the fence with this. I'm fine leaving it just the way it is and say it's just for this site, because the findings I made are for
this site,
this space, this site.
That's why I say keep it simple.
And just keep it simple. And should that happen in 10 years, there may be a whole different philosophy as far as signs go. And then you can work with multiple tenants to push space. But I think for our purposes tonight, I'm not in a position to say, yeah, if it's a little bit bigger. No, I'm so on the fence, I think we leave it the way it is.
Yeah. I agree.
I think that's wise.
Fair enough.
Yeah.
Yeah, at this point, let's just get
fair enough.
Okay, on the fence.
Take your freeway sign and run.
Okay.
Pretty much.
All right. So we've covered all the conditions, right? So would somebody like to make the resolution?
I've got a question now.
Okay.
With the straw vote and everything, just so I understand it, if we're making a resolution to approve everything, including the freeway signage, I don't want to vote for that.
Right.
Right.
Okay.
But you're on the record indicating that you supported the other signs. You are just not in support of the freeway
sign.
Yeah,
but I'm not going to support freeway sign.
Right.
There's two votes we're taking. One is for the master sign program and the monument signs, and the other one is for the frontage and the freeway signs.
So you just vote no on that resolution. But you're on record being supportive of it.
So let me take a stab at 15008, and then I'll... Don't go very far, Sean. Okay, so I move that the Planning Commission, City of San Clemente, approve the resolution number PC 15008, a resolution of the Planning Commission of the City of San Clemente, California, approving discretionary sign permit 15-044, Estrella Shopping Center Master Sign Program Phase 1 for monument signs up to 10 feet tall and establishment of a master sign program for a commercial center located at 550 Camino de Estrella, with the addition of conditional approval number 13, which is worded as such, please, Sean.
The two small wall signs above the entries of the Sprouts facility shall be appropriately located to provide sufficient space between the top of the arches to the bottom of the signs. The intent is to ensure proper proportions and design now and in the future.
You say prior to the issuance of sign permit?
Are we doing the monument?
Yes.
One?
Prior to issuance of sign permit.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, passes 7-0. And. Yes, please. You're doing so well.
Probably part when I need it.
Okay. I move that we approve resolution number PC 15-010, a resolution of the Planning Commission of the City of San Clemente, California, approving Sign Exception Permit 15-045, Estrella Shopping Center Master Sign Program Phase 1, for the oversized signage and one freeway-oriented signage located at 550 Camino de la Estrella, with the addition of conditional use number...
Condition of approval.
Conditional approval number 10, which will read as...
The freeway-oriented sign shall only be utilized by the tenant space adjacent to the freeway. The intent is to ensure that this tenant utilizes the space that has the unique site conditions to approve the freeway-oriented sign. Other tenant spaces or expansion of this tenant space will result in not being able to utilize the freeway-oriented sign.
Second.
Is that the way we want it?
If the question is legally, if it gets you there, yes, it gets you there, especially the language about expansion of the tenant space or other tenant spaces.
As far as we don't have to mention spot C or anything like that. Okay, thank you. So I have moved.
We have a second.
Excuse me, just a minute, but City Planner Pat mentioned that our resolution needed to be changed as well. No, I did talk to the city attorney, and he said that wasn't necessary. Thanks for bringing it up.
Okay.
Well, we were also going to put in there, and maybe I missed it, with regard to the spacing of the other small signs.
Sports Authority?
No, with Sprouts.
No, that was for the master sign program, because the small signs actually...
Thank you for remembering that one. Okay. Yeah, it was on the last one.
And the reason I put it there, just so you know, Mr. Eggleston, is that the smaller signs do not require a sign exception permit.
Right.
And so it should be just associated with the master sign program. That was the reason.
Okay, that's fine.
Okay, so we have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed?
No.
Nay.
No.
Okay. Passes 4-3. I just want to take a minute. I want to thank the commissioners for their thoughtful deliberation on this complex issue. I think the comments that each of you made helped some of us make our determination tonight. So I just wanted to congratulate everybody on their thoughtful remarks. And congratulations, Stephen. We look forward to when do you think now Sprouts will begin moving forward? And it's because they're likely the first to open. Is that correct?
They're likely to be the first to open. We're in the middle of this. We are underway with asbestos abatement, which means no one can go enter the building anyway for this next 2 weeks. So as soon as that is completed, we're cautiously optimistic that we have a building permit and be ready to commence. That's the only thing that's subject to is my question that I was going to ask Sean after the meeting, or Assistant City Attorney after the meeting, or Jim, which is what appeal rights do we need to be concerned about beyond this meeting? So that's the only thing I need to understand. But subject to that, we're moving full steam ahead with Sprouts expecting to open this year.
Great. All right. And staff will follow up with you about your question. Okay. And I also, Mel, I wanted to thank you for your help this evening. Your counsel was very helpful in making our decisions and crafting a resolution. So welcome, and we look forward to having that experience on a regular basis. Okay. Any reports of commissioners?
The Coastal Advisory Committee meeting for this week, in fact, has been canceled due to the joint meeting with the City Council at the end of the month. And then the topics for next month will be additional design on the Trafalgar Canyon runoff and additional efforts in that runoff area. And then in May, we'll have Lauren Tomna, who is the project manager for the Sandag last sanding for about 10 beaches in San Diego, will be a guest speaker at the Coastal Advisory Committee meeting. He's presented before. We have several new members, and that's why we're bringing him back. And ultimately, hopefully, the committee will vote to recommend that it be put on the council agenda. I think it'd be very informative for city council. His experience as the day-to-day project manager for sanding of about 10 or 12 beaches that they did in their second evolution here about a year ago. And that's all I have to report.
Great, thank you.
Just an FYI, the next mobility task force meeting is on the 16th, and it looks like, based on that agenda, that we're targeting May to deliver some work items, a list of a preliminary list of work items to City Council.
Okay, thank you. Bart?
And I just wanted to say I'm going to be out of town April 25th through the 2nd, which means Wayne will be sitting in, I hope, on, I think it's around the 27th or something like that. There's one the last week in April.
Okay.
And since I missed notifying you previously, this.
Yes. I'll soon remind you.
I'm going to be missing a meeting, too, but I'm going to have to check my calendar to see whether it's a design review or a PC meeting. But I will check that this week, and I'll let Jim know as soon as I make that determination. Okay.
Yeah,
April 29th.
Okay.
29th of April. Okay.
If Jim? There's nothing else, I will move that we adjourn to the study session to be held at 6 p.m. on March 18, 2015, in City Council Chambers at City Hall, located 100 Avenue Presidio, San Clemente, California.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Okay, here.